أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم Lesson number 299 سورة القيامة We'll begin from ayah number 20 But before we begin, we'll listen to the recitation from the beginning and then inshallah we'll continue We see over here at the beginning of the surah that there are many people who do not believe in al-qiyamah and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala swears by al-qiyamah itself as well as al-nafs al-lawwamah What's the reason? Why is it that most people don't believe in qiyamah? What's the reason given over here in the ayat? Tell me from the ayah. بَلْ يُرِيدُ الْإِنسَانُ لِيَفْجُرَ أَمَامَهُ He wants to continue in his own ways. He doesn't want to be restricted. He doesn't want to change himself. This is why it's so easy to deny the Day of Judgment. And then we see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says later, describing the Day of Judgment, that يَقُولُ الْإِنسَانُ يَوْمَئِذٍ أَيْنَ الْمَفَرُ That on that day, when the Qiyamah is established, then a person will not be able to escape anywhere. He will not be able to take refuge anywhere. إِلَى رَبِّكَ يَوْمَئِذٍ الْمُسْتَقَرُ To your Lord that day is the finality. Every person is going there. Meaning once the Day of Judgment comes, that's it. There is no escape. And then we see that the Prophet ﷺ is told that he must not move his tongue while the revelation is being sent to him. Why is it so that he was told not to move his tongue when the recitation was being sent to him? What's the reason behind that? Why was he told not to read along with the wahi? Why was he told to listen attentively? When you listen attentively, only then you can learn, only then you can absorb, and only then you can convey. And the Prophet ﷺ's responsibility was to convey. If he didn't take it in properly, how was he to convey further? So this shows to us that in order for a person to convey properly, he must complete the first steps. And of them, the first one is to listen attentively. Why else was he told not to move his tongue? It's of the etiquettes, it's of the adab with the Qur'an that a person must not move his tongue when the recitation is being played. Instead, what should he do? Listen very, very attentively. Which shows to us that if a person must guard his tongue even when the Qur'an is being recited, what about the other parts of his body or what about the other things that he could be doing? Just imagine a person is not allowed to recite along with the recitation. Why? Out of respect. So what does that show? That other things also that are disrespectful must not be done at the same time. For example, talking to one another. This is also something that's not allowed. Why? Because it shows disrespect. We've discussed this earlier as well, that if you're listening to the Qur'an, you're playing the Qur'an, and you're doing your work alongside, best is that you are paying full attention. And this, remember, is in the context of learning. Okay? This is in the context of learning. However, if you don't want to work silently, you're listening, even if you don't catch 100%, you catch 60%, you catch 50%, even that serves as a reminder. So it's okay in that case. However, in the context of learning, what does it show? That a person must be very, very serious and must be very, very respectful. And we learned earlier that part of the adab that the Prophet ﷺ was taught was that وَثِيَابَكَ فَطَهِّرْ Keep your clothes clean. وَالرُّجْزَ فَهْجُرْ So this is also the etiquettes with the Qur'an, that a person must be clean. Clean in his clothes and his body, as well as in his manners. He should be very respectful with the Qur'an. Because remember that if you don't give respect, then you cannot gain anything either. And then we see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, كَلَّا بَلْ تُحِبُّونَ الْعَاجِلَةِ Nay, all of you, what do you like? الْعَاجِلَةِ What is الْعَاجِلَةِ? الْعَاجِلَةِ is that which comes quickly and goes away quickly. And in the Qur'an, the word عَاجِلَة is used for dunya. Why? Because dunya, it comes quickly, it goes away quickly. If, for example, a person is working in order to gain reward in the hereafter, when will he get the reward? After death. But if a person is working to make some money in the dunya, when will he get that money? Now. So it comes quickly. However, does it stay eternally with you? No, it goes away very quickly as well. So Allah says, كَلَّا بَلْ تُحِبُّونَ الْعَاجِلَةِ What does this كَلَّا mean? كَلَّا over here is negating. Negating what? what the people think, what the people assume about the resurrection, that it will not take place, it will not come. So Allah says, Kalla, no way, what you think is wrong. And the reason why you deny the resurrection is, بَلْ تُحِبُّونَ الْعَاجِلَةِ. You love this present life. You love this dunya. And if you think about it, hastiness is something that is ingrained within human beings. They want the results very quickly. Which is why we see that in the previous ayat, where the Prophet ﷺ was told not to move his tongue, what's the reason behind it? Why was he moving his tongue? Why was he reciting along with Jibreel? To make sure that he learned quickly. He learned quickly. He didn't want to miss out on anything. So this is something that's natural within people. They love to get things quickly. They love immediate results. That you just read once or twice and that's it. You should have your lesson memorized. You shouldn't have to read it 7 times. You shouldn't have to read it 10 times. No, this is what we want. Once or twice and that's it. And if we have to do it more than once or twice, then we get fed up or we get very frustrated with ourselves, thinking that we are very weak and this is not meant for us. No, we should be patient. We have learned earlier that إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ خُلِقَ هَلُوعًا. Man has been created very hasty, very small-hearted. إِذَا مَسَّهُ الشَّرُّ جَزُوعًا وَإِذَا مَسَّهُ الْخَيْرُ مَنُوعًا. So كَلَّا بَلْ تُحِبُّونَ الْعَاجِلَةِ. You love this dunya. وَتَذَرُونَ الْآخِرَةِ. And you leave the hereafter. You neglect the hereafter. You forget the hereafter. You don't think about the benefits, the reward of the hereafter. Rather, what are you concerned about? The benefit, the result of this dunya. Which is why anything you do, whatever you plan for, what do you have in mind? Dunya, not the hereafter. And if you think about it realistically, how many times is it that when we're doing something, we really have the akhirah in mind? How many times is it that we have the dunya in mind? If you think about it, generally, typically, people have the dunya in mind. Which is why we get impatient. Which is why we want immediate results. Which is why we don't want to try too hard. Which is why we don't want to change our ways sometimes. So, وَتَذَرُونَ الْآخِرَةِ. You leave the hereafter. And we see that many times, because of this love for dunya and neglect of the hereafter, people make such decisions which are even against the deen. For example, a person loves to get something in this dunya. He doesn't care about what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said concerning it. And he goes for it. And which is why he doesn't even care whether it's halal or it's haram. Making impermissible things lawful for oneself, this is what? Extremely wrong. And what's the reason behind that? Love for dunya and ignoring the hereafter. This is the reason behind that. If you think about it, the Prophet ﷺ, he told us, we learned the Quran as well, that everyone's rizq, it is written. Everyone's rizq is written. Whatever is meant for you will come to you. Which is why the Prophet ﷺ said, أَجْمِلُوا بِالطَّلَبِ. That when you're seeking the rizq, then be good in that. Meaning, don't seek the rizq through unlawful means. Why? Because what is written for you is written for you. It will come to you. But why is it that people ignore what Allah has said? Because they are greedy for dunya. So, كَلَّا بَلْ تُحِبُّونَ الْعَاجِلَةِ وَتَذَرُونَ الْآخِرَةِ. And what does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say with regards to the hereafter? That it is خَيْرٌ, much better, and also أَبْقَى, more lasting, compared to what? Compared to this dunya. وُجُوهٌ يَوْمَئِذٍ نَاضِرَةٌ. Some faces that day will be radiant. On the day of judgment, on يَوْمُ الْقِيَامَةِ, some faces on that day will be نَاضِرَةٌ. Why will they be نَاضِرَةٌ? Because إِلَى رَبِّهَا نَاضِرَةٌ. They'll be looking at their Lord. This is why they'll be radiant, happy, glowing. And the only reason why they're happy is because they're looking at Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And who will Allah give this tawfiq to on the day of judgment? Those that He is pleased with. And who is it that Allah is pleased with? Those who did not ignore the hereafter, but rather their purpose, their goal, their striving was for what? The hereafter. So those faces on that day will be nadira. Nadira is from the root letters noon, dadra, and nadra, nadratun na'im, nudur. Nabdha is basically freshness. When something is fresh, and when something is fresh, is very beautiful. It glows as well. Like for example, compare a fresh flower to a dry flower. Compare a fresh flower that is still on the plant to a flower that has been plucked off, that has been taken off, that has been picked. Is there a difference between the two? Is there? A huge difference. One is fresh, more bright, more beautiful, more radiant in its color. And the other is not as fresh, is not as bright, is not radiant in its color. Similarly, the one that's on the plant is fresh, it's very firm. And the other one, it's drooping. The petals are withering. So there is a clear difference between that which is fresh and that which is not fresh. That which is fresh is more beautiful. It is more beautiful. So وُجُوهٌ يَوْمَئِذٍ نَاضِرَةٌ. What does نَاضِرَةٌ mean? Fresh, beautiful, glowing, radiant. And it's also said that نَضْرَة is the freshness and glow of the face. When the face is fresh and it's also glowing. Now think about it. When is a person's face glowing? When there's light on the face? Or when there's a lot of makeup on the face? When is it actually glowing? When a person is happy. Because the face is a direct reflection of how a person is feeling. The face is a reflection of how a person is feeling on the inside. If a person is happy, automatically feelings of happiness will be visible on the face. A person is sad, sadness will be visible on the face. A person is worried, the tension will be there on the face. So the face reflects exactly how you're feeling inside. So وُجُوهٌ يَوْمَئِذٍ نَاضِرَةٌ. Some faces will be bright, radiant. Why? Because they are truly happy on the inside. And why is it that they're very, very happy on the inside? Because إِلَى رَبِّهَا نَاظِرَةٌ. نَاظِرَةٌ, one who sees, one who looks. They'll be looking at Allah. And because they'll be looking at Allah, as a result of that, they'll be extremely happy. So happy that their faces will be shining. In Surah Abasa, ayah 38-39, we learn, وُجُوهٌ يَوْمَئِذٍ مُسْفِرَةٌ ضَاحِكَةٌ مُسْتَبْشِرَةٌ. Over there, what do we learn? ضَاحِكَةٌ. That some faces that day will be bright, laughing. Laughing out of joy. Rejoicing at the good news that they're being given. So rejoicing, laughing, excited. Why? Because إِلَى رَبِّهَا نَاظِرَةٌ. And we learn that every time the people of Jannah will see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what's going to happen? It's going to increase them in their beauty. It's going to increase them in their happiness, in their radiance, in their glow. Their faces will become more radiant. Because they'll increase in their happiness on the inside. We learned that the Prophet ﷺ said, when the people of paradise enter paradise, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say to them, do you want me to give you anything extra? Do you want me to give you anything extra? Is that possible in dunya? No, in dunya, you barely get, you know, everything you want. In Jannah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be asking the people of Jannah, you want something else, you want something else. And they will say, haven't you whitened our faces? Meaning, haven't you made our faces so fresh? Haven't you entered us into paradise and saved us from the fire? Meaning, we have everything we could ever want. What more could there be? Then Allah will remove the veil and they will not be given anything more beloved to them than looking at their Lord. And that will be the extra that we learn. لِلَّذِينَ أَحْسَنُوا الْحُسْنَى وَزِيَادَ. So this is the extra. And this is why we see that the Prophet ﷺ used to make dua to Allah. That, O Allah, وَأَسْأَلُكَ لَذَّةَ النَّظَرِ إِلَىٰ وَجْهِكَ. That I ask you for the delight, the pleasure, the ladha of looking at your face. I want to experience that ladha, that happiness that cannot be attained by any other thing. You know, when you look at something beautiful, then automatically you feel happy. But the ladha that a person will get by looking at Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that happiness cannot be attained by anything else. Nothing else. Because Allah, لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ. There is nothing at all like Him. No one who's like Him. And just imagine, وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَشَدُّ حُبًّا لِلَّهِ. So when a person loves someone and finally they get to see them, imagine the happiness. So this will make the people of Jannah so happy that they will become more beautiful as a result. They will be glowing, their faces will be glowing even more. And we learn from another hadith of the Sahaba, they asked the Prophet ﷺ that, O Messenger of Allah, will we see our Lord on the Day of Judgment? Will actually see Him? They asked the Prophet ﷺ. And he replied, are you harmed by seeing the sun and the moon when there are no clouds beneath them? Meaning when the sun is in the sky, when the moon is in the sky, are you harmed by looking at them? They replied, no. The Prophet ﷺ said, then you will surely see your Lord like that. That just as you enjoy looking at the moon, you enjoy looking at the sun, meaning at a time when it's not difficult for you to see, and as you see, it makes you happy. This is how you'll be able to see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we see Musa alayhi salam, because he loved Allah so much, what did he say? Rabbi arini anzur ilayk. Oh my Lord, show me yourself, I want to look at you. Because this is a reality. When someone loves another, what do they want? They want to see them. They want to see them. Which is why we see that people, when they love someone, they have their pictures on their phones even. Every time they turn on their phone, they will see their picture. Sometimes as the desktop on their computer. Why? Because every time you see them, it makes you more happy. And you never have enough of seeing them. You never have enough of looking at them. So وُجُوهٌ يَوْمَئِذٍ نَاظِرَةٌ إِلَىٰ رَبِّهَا نَاظِرَةٌ. To their Lord, looking on. And you see the word nazira? Looking on. That they will not be attracted by anything else. Looking on continuously at who? At the face of Allah Azza wa Jal. You know, like as if someone is mesmerized. That when you are just looking at something and you just fall in love with it, you don't want to take your eyes off. You know, for example, sometimes children are just busy watching something or reading something. And you walk by them, you try to talk to them, you try to show them something. They won't look away. They're constantly looking at what they're looking at, and they'll say, yeah, no, okay, later. They won't move their eyes. They won't take their eyes off. They won't be distracted by anything. إِلَىٰ رَبِّهَا نَاظِرَةٌ. Constantly looking, constantly gazing, never having enough. إِلَىٰ رَبِّهَا نَاظِرَةٌ. And we see that on the other hand, there will be some people who will not be able to see Allah. Who will not be able to see Allah at all. In Surah Al-Mutaffifin, Ayah 15, we learn, كَلَّا إِنَّهُمْ عَنْ رَبِّهِمْ يَوْمَئِذٍ لَمَحْجُوبُونَ. No, indeed, from their Lord that day, they will be partitioned. They will be screened. They will not be able to see Allah. وَوُجُوهٌ. And some faces, يَوْمَئِذٍ, on that day, بَاسِرَةٌ. They'll be contorted. They'll be gloomy. They'll be frowning. Basira. Basira, from the root letters, basinra. Thumma abasa wa basara. And what does that mean? To intensify the frown that is on a person's face. How? To continue to scowl, to continue to frown, to continue to wrinkle the skin that is in between the eyebrows of a person. When the face of a person is twisted and bent out of normal shape. That it's not normal anymore. It's twisted and bent out of normal shape. So, وَوُجُوهٌ يَوْمَئِذٍ بَاسِرَةٌ. Some faces that day will be frowning, dark, gloomy, without any radiance. All the sadness will be where? On their faces. The people of Jannah, all their happiness is where? On their faces. The people of Hellfire, all their sadness is on their faces. وَوُجُوهٌ يَوْمَئِذٍ بَاسِرَةٌ. And basara literally is when something is done before its right time. What does it mean literally? When something is done before its right time. So basara means they will go bad, they will be sad before they should actually be sad. Technically, when is it that the faces of the criminals should be very, very sad? When they are admitted into the hellfire. When they are sent to the punishment. But we see over here that even before that, their faces will be basira. Why? because تظنوا expecting they will be certain أن يفعل بها فاقرة that they will be done to them something backbreaking. That in the plane of Hashr only they will know that something terrible is going to happen, that they will be sent to the hellfire, they will be sentenced over there. So even before they are sent to the hellfire in the plane of Hashr only, what's going to happen? Their faces will be covered in gloom. They'll be sad, full of sadness. In Surah Abasa, ayah 40-42, we learn, وَوُجُوهُ يَوْمَئِذٍ عَلَيْهَا غَبَرَةٌ تَرْهَقُهَا قَتَرَةٌ أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْكَفَرَةُ الْفَجَرَةُ. That other faces that day will have upon them dust, as if they're covered in dust. Blackness will cover them, darkness will cover them. And those are the disbelievers, the wicked ones. The wicked ones. So why is it so that their faces will be basara? Because of the horrors that they will experience of that day. Because of the intensity of the punishment that they will experience even before entering hellfire. Which is why we learn elsewhere that فَكَيْفَ تَتَّقُونَ إِن كَفَرْتُمْ يَوْمَ يَجْعَلُ الْوِلْدَانَ شِيبًا. The intensity of the Day of Judgment is so severe that children will turn grey-haired. So imagine those who are to be sent to the hellfire, how sad they will be. For example, when a criminal, a guilty person is caught, and he's brought in the court, and he knows he's in trouble, he has a feeling that it's going to be against him. How is his face? You can see this gloom, the sadness, the worry, the fear on the face, even before the final sentence is made. تَظُنُّ. It will be certain أَن يُفْعَلَ بِهَا فَاقِرَةً. That something فَاقِرَةً is going to happen with it. What is فَاقِرَةً? فَاقِرَةً is from the root letters فَاقَافْرَ. What does فَاقُر mean? Poverty. And from the same root is the word فِقَار. And فِقَار is used for the vertebra or the small bones of the backbone of the spine. And فَاقِرَةً is that which breaks the spine. That which crushes the spine. And this is figurative for what? A spine breaking calamity, meaning a disaster, a catastrophe, a punishment that is so severe that it's going to break their back. You know, when you say, I feel as though my back is broken, what does it mean? What does it mean? You're extremely exhausted, extremely tired. And we see that the back issues, many times they are a result of not physical fatigue, but rather they are a result of what? Tension and worry as well. Stress as well. So, تَظُنُّ أَن يُفْعَلَ بِهَا فَاقِرَةً. That something back-breaking is going to happen. Meaning something terrible, a great catastrophe is going to befall them. A great punishment is going to befall them. That very soon, they're going to be punished. They're going to be admitted into the fire. They're going to be screened from their Lord, unable to see Him. Allah says, Kalla, nay, never, by no means. What is this Kalla negating? That you all love Al-Ajila, وَتَذَرُونَ الْآخِرَةَ. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives a brief description of what will happen in the hereafter. Then Allah says, Kalla, this is wrong. You should not be in love with Al-Ajila. You should not leave the Akhirah, because look at the Akhirah. If a person is happy there, he's successful. And if a person is sad there, تَظُنُّ أَن يُفْعَلَ بِهَا فَاقِرَةً. So, كَلَّا. Don't be lost in the life of this world. Don't be in love with the life of this world. Don't ignore the hereafter. Why? Because the hereafter is real. And this dunya, you're not going to have it for eternity. إِذَا بَلَغَتِ التَّرَاقِي. When the soul has reached the collarbone. You love this dunya, you're lost in it. Remember, you're not staying here forever. Eventually you will leave and you will be made to go to the hereafter. When? إِذَا بَلَغَتِ التَّرَاقِي. بَلَغَتْ. It reached. What reached? The soul, the ruh of the dying person. When it reaches up, التَّرَاقِي, the collarbone. تَرَاقِي is the plural of تَرْقُوَة. From the root letters, ta, ra, qaf, waw. And tarquwa is the collarbone. What is it? The collarbone. In the following ayat is the mention of death. That how death happens, how the soul of a person leaves his body. And remember, that death is the beginning of qiyamah. It is the beginning of a person's hereafter. Earlier we learned about al-qiyamah, that when that will be established, a person will say, "Ayn al-mafar? Where can I run to? Where can I escape?" And he will be told that that's it, there is no escape now. Similarly, when it comes to a person's death, when it comes to the soul leaving the body, can a person escape? Can he go anywhere? Can he save himself? Can he hold on to the dunya? He cannot. إِذَا بَلَغَتِ التَّرَاقِي. When the soul reaches up the collarbone. And why is this description given over here? The soul reaches up the collarbone. Because this is something understood, that when the soul leaves the body, it is extracted first from the feet. And then it's taken upwards. And eventually, it's taken up to the collarbone, and then it's finally taken out of the body. So, إِذَا بَلَغَتِ التَّرَاقِي. When the soul will be pulled out of the body, it will reach the collarbones. وَقِيلَ. And it is said, مَنْ رَاق. Who will cure him? It is said, by who? By those people who are around the dying person. Because when a person is at the verge of death, is at the verge of dying, who is around him? His family members, his friends, sometimes doctors, sometimes nurses, sometimes friends, I mean people they're very close with. They're around him, and as a person's soul is leaving the body, what is said by all those people? Man raqin. Is there anyone who can cure him? Is there anyone who can save him? Who can save him? Man raqin. No one can cure him then. No one can do anything to keep his soul. Raqin. Raqin is ism fa'il, and this is from the root letters raqafya, ruqya. What does ruqya mean? Ruqya. Now that you've done aqidah, what does ruqya mean? Remedy. What kind of remedy is it? What kind of treatment is it? To read something and blow it on the person. To read something and blow it on the person. And raqin is one who does that. So one who reads and blows. Why? In order to cure. And the word raqin is not just used for someone who reads and blows and as a result cures, but rather it's also used for a physician, meaning someone who can treat the other, someone who can cure the other. And many times we see that when it comes to ruqya, this is the last thing that people resort to. When they've tried everything else, nothing else works, and what do? They try some ruqya. So وَقِيلَ مَنْ رَاق. And it is said, who will cure him? Is there any physician? Is there any doctor? Is there anyone who can come and read something on him and cure him? Can they cure him? Can anyone do that? No. No one can protect him now. Because if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has decided that that person must die at that time, his soul must leave the body, then no one can revive him. And we see that, for example, when a person is at the verge of dying as a result of a heart attack, for instance, how they shock the person, how they do so many things in order to revive him, but can they? They cannot. And sometimes it's to the point where the ribs even break. It's so severe. It's so severe that the ribs even break, the rest of the body gets wounded and injured, but they try every measure, every step to rescue the soul, to keep the soul, but they cannot keep the soul. وَقِيلَ مَنْ رَاق. It is said, who will cure him? No one can cure him. Because when it comes to the soul, we have no power over it. In Surah Al-Waqi'ah, ayah 83-87 also we learn, فَلَوْلَا إِذَا بَلَغَتِ الْحُلْقُومِ وَأَنْتُمْ حِينَئِذٍ تَنْظُرُونَ وَنَحْنُ أَقْرَبُ إِلَيْهِ مِنْكُمْ وَلَكِنْ لَا تُبْصِرُونَ فَلَوْلَا إِن كُنْتُمْ غَيْرَ مَدِينِينَ تَرْجِعُونَهَا إِن كُنْتُمْ صَادِقِينَ. But can you return the soul? You cannot. Can you keep the soul? You cannot. And if you've ever seen a person die, or you've heard a story of someone who has witnessed such a scene, people are just standing helpless. They're just standing helpless. I remember I visited the hospital once to see someone who had just had a stroke a few days ago, and when I went there, all of the relatives that were there, And they were crying and they were saying, she's going, she's going, she's going. Because constantly, you know, the doctors were like, sorry, we cannot do anything, sorry, we cannot do anything. Everything they tried, it wasn't working. And outside, the entire family was crying, she's going. She's going, and you cannot do anything to keep her. Even if you get the best doctors and the best treatment, everything in time even, you cannot save her. وَظَنَّ And he is certain, أَنَّهُ الْفِرَاقِ That it is the time of separation. ظَنَّ Meaning, the person who is dying, at this point he is certain that that's it, this is the time of separation. This is the time of parting. فِرَاق فَرَاقَ Meaning, this is the time that I leave this dunya. This is the time that I leave my family, I leave my children, I leave my belongings, I leave my body. وَظَنَّ أَنَّهُ الْفِرَاقِ All life long, he thought, this is forever. He held on to his things. He clung to those people whom he loved. وَظَنَّ أَنَّهُ الْفِرَاقِ But now he cannot stay with them. No matter how much he wants, no matter how much they try to keep him. وَظَنَّ أَنَّهُ الْفِرَاقِ وَالْتَفَّتِ السَّاقُ بِالسَّاقِ And the leg is wound about the other leg. وَالْتَفَّتِ التفت لام فا فا لف is to join one thing with the other such that both are completely attached together. So one saq, and saq is the lower leg, the shin, one leg is attached with the other leg. What does it mean by this? One leg is attached with the other leg. Meaning now, there is no more life left in the legs. He cannot have any control over them. The same legs that he used to walk with, the same legs he had full control over, he could go from place to place. He could move them however, whenever he wanted. But now, one leg is joined with the other, and he has no more control over them. His legs are laying lifeless. وَالْتَفَّتِ السَّاقُ بِالسَّاقُ At the moment of death, when the soul is leaving the body, then what happens? Eventually the body begins to become cold. And as it becomes cold, a person cannot move. وَالْتَفَّتِ السَّاقُ بِالسَّاقُ One leg joins with the other. Some have said that وَالْتَفَّتِ السَّاقُ بِالسَّاقُ What this means is that one distress is joined with the other. One distress is coupled with the other. Because we learned earlier that on the Day of Judgment, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will uncover his shin. وَيُدْعَوْنَ إِلَى السُّجُودِ And the people will be commanded to do sajda, but some people will not be able to do sajda. And over there I told you one of the meanings, that in the Arabic expression, the word saq is also used for difficulty. It's also used for a catastrophe, a calamity. So, وَالْتَفَّتِ السَّاقُ بِالسَّاقُ Meaning one distress, one difficulty is joined with the other distress. One distress of leaving this dunya and the other distress of arriving in the hereafter. Leaving the dunya, a person is sad that I'm leaving behind all these people, I'm leaving behind all of these things. I will not see these things anymore, I will not do these things anymore, I will not meet these people anymore. One distress joined with the other distress, what's there for me in the hereafter? What's going to happen now? وَالْتَفَّتِ السَّاقُ بِالسَّاقُ One difficulty followed by another difficulty. إِلَىٰ رَبِّكَ يَوْمَئِذٍ الْمَسَاقُ To your Lord that day will be the procession. مساق سين وَوْقَافْ سِيَاقَ سِيَاقَ is driving. وَسِيقَ الَّذِينَ اتَّقَوْا إِلَىٰ رَبِّكَ يَوْمَئِذٍ الْمَسَاقُ Today, this day, you're going towards your Lord. You're being taken towards your Lord. You're being taken towards your Lord for what purpose? For the purpose of judgment. You cannot go back to dunya. Now, you're going to your Lord. And this is why we see that a believer at the time of his death, he's given good news. Which is why, what does he want? That he is taken to his Lord quickly. إِلَىٰ رَبِّكَ يَوْمَئِذٍ الْمَسَاقِ He is happy. He cannot wait. So when he is excited about meeting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah also wants to meet him. And on the other hand, the one who's given bad news, he doesn't want to meet Allah. He doesn't want to. witness. He doesn't want to come face to face with his hisab. And because he doesn't want to meet Allah, Allah also does not want to meet him. إِلَىٰ رَبِّكَ يَوْمَ إِذِ الْمَسَاقِ فَلَا صَدَّقَ وَلَا صَلَّىٰ. So he did not believe, nor did he pray. Who? This man. And in the context, who does this man refer to? The one who did not believe in the Qiyamah. The one who was in constant denial of it. فَلَا صَدَّقَ وَلَا صَلَّىٰ. He did not believe, nor did he pray. وَلَكِنْ كَذَّبَ. But rather he denied. وَتَوَلَّىٰ. And he turned away. He did not believe, and he turned away from all acts of obedience. So he never obeyed Allah. When he never obeyed Allah, obviously, he is afraid. And in the dunya, how was he? ثُمَّ ذَهَبَ إِلَىٰ أَهْلِهِ يَتَمَطَّى. And then he went to his people, swaggering in pride. In the dunya, he never believed. He never obeyed Allah. Rather, he did كَذَّبَ وَتَوَلَّىٰ. And then when he did tawalla, ثُمَّ ذَهَبَ إِلَىٰ أَهْلِهِ يَتَمَطَّى. يَتَمَطَّى is from the root letters ميم طا واو. مطون is to walk fast, to hurry. And مطيّة is used for a camel ride. When a person is riding a camel, or if you ever see a camel walking, how does it walk? How? The neck is up, and it's very slow, especially when the camel is walking. The person who is sitting on the camel, he's being swayed from side to side. As a camel steps forward, you go onto your right side. As it takes the next step, you go onto your left side. So you're going from side to side constantly. So from this, yatamatta is to walk arrogantly with one's arms away from the sides. So a person, as he walks, as he takes one step, with the step goes the right arm in front, and then the left step, the left arm goes in front, away from the sides, walking in a very arrogant fashion. Gangster walk, you can say. And when does a person walk like that? When? When he thinks he's everything. When he thinks he doesn't need anybody. He doesn't care about anyone. Because a person who is considerate about others, how will he walk? With himself? Together. In a very decent fashion. And when a person thinks he's all that, and he doesn't need anyone, he doesn't care about anyone, then he will walk with his arms away from the sides, swaggering arrogantly. ثُمَّ ذَهَبَ إِلَىٰ أَهْلِهِ يَتَمَطَّى. It is said about Abu Jahl that he would come to the gathering of the Prophet ﷺ when he would recite the Qur'an to the people. He would do da'wah to them. And he would listen. And Abu Jahl, he would listen. But then after some time, he would turn away arrogantly. He would go away to his family. He would go back home. And how would he walk? يَتَمَطَّى. I don't need to listen to this stuff. This stuff doesn't affect me. There's no need. So ثُمَّ ذَهَبَ إِلَىٰ أَهْلِهِ يَتَمَطَّى. Allah says, أَوْلَى لَكَ فَأَوْلَىٰ. Woe to you and woe. ثُمَّ أَوْلَىٰ لَكَ فَأَوْلَىٰ. Then again woe to you and woe. Woe to you again and again. Notice how أَوْلَىٰ has been said how many times? 4 times. Typically, how many times is something repeated? Twice? Maybe thrice? Over here we see أَوْلَى is mentioned 4 times. أَوْلَى لَكَ فَأَوْلَى. ثُمَّ أَوْلَى لَكَ فَأَوْلَى. Woe to you. Woe to you. Again, again. And this أَوْلَى, this is from وَاوْ يَا لَمْ. Wail. Remember that sometimes in the Arabic language, for some words, the spellings are changed in the sense that the root letters, they're swapped. So, wail, waw, ya, lam, this is the root. And awla, this is af'al. So what does it mean? A big woe, a great woe, a big woe to you. And this lam, awla, laka, lam over here is of sila, which means, and together, awla, laka, this serves as a threat. So, awla, laka, as reproach. أَوْلَى لَكَ فَأَوْلَى. And secondly, أَوْلَى has also been understood as from the root letters وَاوْ لَامْ يَا وَلِيَ. And what does وَلِيَ mean? Literally, to be close. So أَوْلَى, closer to you. May it be very close to you. What may be very close to you? Destruction, punishment. And أَوْلَى لَكَ meaning it is very close to you. What is very close to you? What you did not want to believe in. The day of judgment, the qiyamah, you rejected. you didn't even want to think about it. You didn't even want to prepare for it. But now that your death has come, أَوْلَى لَكَ. That same thing that you were so averse to is so close to you, is so near to you. فَأَوْلَى, even nearer. ثُمَّ أَوْلَى لَكَ فَأَوْلَى. It is even more close to you. More closer to you than you ever expected. ثُمَّ أَوْلَى لَكَ فَأَوْلَى. Allah says, أَيَحْسَبُ الْإِنسَانُ أَن يُتْرَكَ سُدَى. Does man think that he will be left neglected? Does he think that he will be left on his own? Suda, this is the plural of Sadi, from the root letters Sin, Dal, Ya. And Sadi is used for a she-camel that walks with big steps. What is it? A she-camel that walks with big steps. And when it's walking, taking big steps, then it's randomly going about here and there. So basically it's used for a camel that is wild, that is not tamed. So it has too much time on its hands, and it goes around aimlessly. It is not tied up, it's not restricted, it has no limitations. So, أَيَحْسَبُ الْإِنسَانُ أَن يُتْرَكَ سُدَى. Does man think that he will be left on his own, free, untied, like an untied she-camel? That he can go anywhere, he can do anything, he has no responsibilities, no obligations, no commands, no prohibitions, no rules, nothing? And at the end he will never be held accountable? Is that what he thinks? أَيَحْسَبُ الْإِنسَانُ أَن يُتْرَكَ سُدَى. Allah says in Surah Al-Mu'minun, Ayah 115 also, أَفَحَسِبْتُمْ أَنَّمَا خَلَقْنَاكُمْ عَبَثًا وَأَنَّكُمْ إِلَيْنَا لَا تُرْجَعُونَ. Is that what you think? Allah questions, أَلَمْ يَكُنْ نُطْفَةً. Had he not been a sperm, مِمْ مَنِيٍّ, from semen, يُمْنَى, emitted? What was he? Was he not a nutfa of mani? Mani is the semen, and yumna from the root letters mim nun ya. What does that mean? When something is emitted, when something is shed, ejaculated, so one that was deposited in the womb of the mother. Wasn't he something so despicable before that was deposited in the womb of the mother? And who is it that created him from there? ثُمَّ كَانَ عَلَقَةً. And then he was an alaqa, a clinging clot. فَخَلَقَ. So he created. Who created? Allah created him. Allah continued to make him grow so that he went from alaqa to all of the various stages of creation. And then فَسَوَّى. And then finally he proportioned him. سَوَّى, تَسْوِيَ. What does that mean? To make something smooth and well proportioned, well balanced. So what was he before? Nothing. A nutfa, emitted into the womb of the mother. Allah made him alaqa, that he was attached to the womb then, a blood clot. And then fasawwa, he gave him a final form as well. Faja'ala minhu, and then he made of him azawjain, two mates. Al-dhakar, the male, wal-unsa, and the female. Meaning, either Allah made him into a male or a female. So Allah is the one who created this person from what? فَجَعَلَ مِنْهُ. From what? What does who refer to? That drop of sperm that was put in the womb. And Allah made him grow. And Allah made him either ذَكَر or unsa. So Allah did not just make human beings, but rather He determined their gender as well. Elsewhere in the Quran also, in Surah Al-Najm, Ayah 45 to 47, we learn, وَأَنَّهُ خَلَقَ الزَّوْجَيْنِ الذَّكَرَ وَالْأُنْسَى مِن نُطْفَةٍ إِذَا تُمْنَى وَأَنَّ عَلَيْهِ النَّشْأَةَ الْأُخْرَى. So the same Lord who created you, أَلَيْسَ ذَلِكَ, is not that. That, meaning that doer of such things, the Khaliq of the nutfa, and then from there, and then finally sawwa, alaysa dhalika, that one who has done this, is he not biqadirin, definitely able, ala an yuhiya al-mawta, upon giving life to the dead? Is he not able to give life to the dead then? If he can create a human being from a nutfa, can he not resurrect the dead? What's the answer? Yes, he can. Subhanakallahumma bala. Glorified are you, Allah? Definitely you can. أَلَيْسَ ذَٰلِكَ بِقَادِرٍ عَلَىٰ أَن يُحْيَ الْمَوْتَىٰ. Of course he can. So if he can create human beings from nutfa, he can definitely resurrect them. And when he can resurrect them, and when he has said there will be al-qiyamah, there will be al-qiyamah. There is no denial. Recitation. If you look in the surah, how the helplessness of human beings has been described. That when death comes to you, you cannot save yourself. When death comes to one of you, you cannot save that person. Then this little time that you have in this dunya, how can you spend that arrogantly away from Allah? When the day of judgment comes, you cannot save yourself, you cannot run away. إِلَىٰ رَبِّكَ يَوْمَ إِذِنِ الْمَسَاقِ. You will be taken to your Lord. And when you are going to be taken to Him, then why be in love with this dunya and leave the hereafter? We'll listen to the recitation one more time.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
لا أقسم بيوم القيامة ولا أقسم بالنفس اللوامة أيحسب الإنسان أن لن نجمع عظامه بلى قادرين على أن نسوي بنانه بل يريد الإنسان ليفجر أمامه يسأل أيان يوم القيامة فإذا برق البصر وخسف القمر وجمع الشمس والقمر يقول الإنسان يومئذ أين المفر كلا لا وزر إلى ربك يومئذ المستقر ينبأ الإنسان يومئذ بما قدم وأخر بل الإنسان على نفسه بصيرة ولو ألقى معاذيره لا تحرك به لسانك لتعجل به لا تحرك به لسانك لتعجل به إن علينا جمعه وقرآنه فإذا قرأناه فاتبع قرآنه ثم إن علينا بيانه كلا بل تحبون العاجلة وتذرون الآخرة وجوه يومئذ ناظرة إلى ربها ناظرة ووجوه يومئذ باسرة تظن أن يفعل بها فاقرة تظن أن يفعل بها فاقرة كلا إذا بلغت التراقي وقيل من راق وقيل من راق وظن أنه الفراق والتفت الساق بالساق إلى ربك يومئذ المساق فلا صدق ولا صلى ولكن كذب وتولى ثم ذهب إلى أهله يتمطى أولى لك فأولى ثم أولى لك فأولى أيحسب الإنسان أن يترك سدى أيحسب الإنسان أن يترك سدى أيحسب الإنسان أن يترك سدى ألم يك نطفة من مني يمنى ثم كان علقة فخلق فسوى فجعل منه الزوجين الذكر والأنثى أليس ذلك بقادر على أن يحيي الموتى.
سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك نشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت نستغفرك ونتوب إليك. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.